Hello again, StruckWeb. Today I'm bringing you another build video for Torchlight 3, and this one is for the Forged class with the Blood Drinker subclass. I've called it Seeker's Uppercut, mainly because it's using Blood Seekers and combining it with the centerpiece of the build, the new entry worked steam-powered uppercut that used to be known as servo-driven uppercut. The build is interesting, it's fun, it's a melee, purely melee build, even though on my skill bar you might see poison dart. That's just a 0 point poison dart, and you can put any other item granted or other skill there as a filler. I have very bad gear when recording the footage that you're seeing. I had very bad gear then, so I intentionally didn't equip super good damage weapon, and I was missing items with servo-driven damage uppercut bonuses. But I think with good gear, without any Fazir bonus damage affixes. So let's say you have 0% on your items Fazir damage bonuses, you can probably reach around a million or more damage with servo-driven uppercut. Basically, you can get 4,000 weapon damage per hit with or higher with servo-driven uppercut when you min-max the build, if that's better to put it. The build is nice, it has enough survivability due to the healing of Blood Seekers, due to the defense of Vortex Bomb, due to the defense of Power Projection, which also can heal. In general, we're using either Cyclone Mode, which is my preferred choice, or a Rapid Strike to generate heat. And then we vent the heat with Vortex Bomb, and I'm using the Mountain King Wheel to get 50 heat back when I vent. So I don't need to generate as much, and we're using as Team Spender the uppercut. I really like the build, and I hope you like it as much as I do. I would start with showing you the skills first. And here we are at the skills segment, where I talk about which skills, at what level, and why I've taken for that build. First, I'm gonna go over the two skill trees and the one subclass skill tree by clicking on them, so you can see the numbers if you wanna skip ahead and not watch the rest of the segment. And then I'm gonna talk in detail. So, what we are centering around is steam powered uppercut. This is the centerpiece. We're building around this skill. So tier 3 steam powered uppercut, needless to say why. Extra damage and getting that double damage of every third hit of steam powered uppercut. And in general, it's just necessary for such a build if that's our main damage source. Then Vent Vortex Bomb, I really love it, regardless whether it's a melee build or a ranged build. I just don't think Cold Launch is worth it, because it doesn't give you as much defense as Vortex Bomb can give you. Vortex Bomb tier 2 also gives you damage reduction, and it's pretty decent synergy with Cyclone Mode and Rapid Strike. So I really love Vortex Bomb, and it's tier 3 as well. Another thing that needs to be tier 3 is Blood Seekers, because that's another centerpiece of the build, not the main, but the support centerpiece. That's why the build is called Seeker's Uppercut. So this one at tier 3, this one at tier 3, and this one at tier 3 are must have. Now you have a choice to make. Do you want to go tier 3 Cyclone and tier 2 Rapid Strike, or do you want to go tier 3 Rapid Strike and then tier 2 Cyclone? In fact, tier 2 Cyclone is optional, but I strongly suggest taking it on a Rapid Strike build. So this is completely optional. 8 points here, 4 points here, or 8 points here, 4 points here. Obviously, if you need, you put 10 points if you're not using the points from the set bonus from the Mountain King set. Now, something I would strongly suggest not skipping out on would be tier 2 Fracking Strike. 10% cooldown for all forged skills reduces the cooldown of Vortex Bomb to 3.6 seconds on top of the cooldown reduction we get from the skill itself. It reduces the cooldown of things like power projection, and it should reduce the cooldown of things like ramming robot, but it doesn't. It should reduce the cooldown of steam powered uppercut when using the servo blade, but it doesn't. And I think if what they did to the disc mage is anything to go on as a kind of prediction what's gonna happen. If they do it with all other classes the same way they did it to Forged, this cooldown would not be just to Forged skills, but it would also apply to other things such as, for example, Living Barrier or whatever other barrier you're using based on the relic, which is pretty decent. I would strongly suggest 1 point into Ramming Robot, so you can get the tier 1 bonus for extra charge when you have the set bonus, and 1 point into power projection again for the same reason to get the tier 1 bonus. Again, keep in mind you have to get the +2 bro skills from the Mountain King helmet, which ideally you would be wearing, and the +2 brass skills from the cuirass, which ideally you would be wearing. Now, I really, really think you shouldn't skip on Sonic Pulse tier 3. Sonic Pulse tier 3 is amazing, and on builds where you're using a steam spender like uppercut, like fracking strike, like critical mass or pressure shot or a basic attack even, you would want that. It would increase the damage they do by 40% for 6 seconds. It also makes the enemies take 40% damage for a specific amount of time. It also benefits from the cooldown from fracking strike tier 2. So tier 3 here is a must have. Now, what is optional is tier 2 vent call launch. Tier 2 vent call launch right now, the only thing it does is increases the damage of Vortex Bomb by 25%. If you don't want to rely on Vortex Bomb too much for damage, then don't take those 4 points and spend them elsewhere. For example, you can get extra damage to relic skills, which again is not our main source of damage. It's just an additional secondary source of damage from Bloodseekers. You can get this one that gives you block chance after venting, and then maybe not wear a shield and wear offhand such as the Liu General, which doesn't go very well with this build, so maybe another offhand. Or you could spend those points on things like Body Chalice, or even put it into more Dance of Death. There's options, maybe more points into Energizer. But I think the way I've set up the skills is my preferred and optimal suggestion for everyone to try. So, on the Relic side of things, as you saw, maxed out Bloodseekers. I've put 1 point into Dance of Death just so I can have it there. Ideally, I won't even use Dance of Death. Ideally, I would use when they re-add it into the game, the Echoes of Life, maybe, because I think I like it more. But consider investing into tier 1 for the bleeding, because that bleeding would stack up well with Rupture if you need extra bleeding. I don't think I need it much, because I do bleed pretty quickly. But that's something to consider. So Rupture and Bloodletter I max out, and I suggest you do the same. It goes very well with builds like Cyclone Mode, Rapid Strike or Rapid Fire, where you have a lot of procs per second, a lot of hits per second. And 3 points into Energizer, and that pretty much sums up the skills and some of the suggestions where you could put points. If you feel like it, you could even, instead of using Dance of Death, you can try and maybe put points into Drain, but I don't know, I don't think it's gonna be that great of an idea. I will make a Drain build next for this one, which would be rework of my Drain build, and where Drain would be the centerpiece, max level, and where Bloodseekers would just be as a support and nothing more. So for the Legendarium, before I explain what items would go there, I want to mention first that I have very bad gear in regards to synergies. I don't have the legendary items I want. I probably have like 40-50% of them. Ideally, I would be wearing 3 pieces of Mountain King and 3 pieces of Winter Weave, and then swatting some other pieces of those sets in my Legendarium alongside the Servo Blade. My ideal setup in the Legendarium would be a servo blade, a mountain king cuirass, and winter weave gauntlets or the winter weave wheel. I prefer the gauntlets, but the winter weave wheel is not bad as well. So that would leave us with wearing mountain king helmet, gauntlets, and mountain king wheel. And we're wearing winter weave cuirass, hatch, and pauldrons. I strongly suggest not using mounting king pauldrons and not using mounting king hatch. The others you can rotate. You can wear the mounting king cuirass and swat the winter weave cuirass. You can wear mounting king gauntlets and swat the winter weave gauntlets, or vice versa. You can wear mounting king wheel or the winter weave wheel, and vice versa. Things can be replaced, but ideally you want 4 pieces mounting king and 3 pieces of the winter weave that are must have. So mounting king helmet, mounting king gauntlets, mounting king wheel, and mounting king cuirass are must have. Winter weave cuirass, in my opinion, is must have. Winter weave gauntlets is a must have. The rest are optional, in my opinion, for that build. Obviously, the potions of the potion cooldown of the winter weave wheel would be very good for the early levels, and more about that in the gear segment. But that's how I would do it: servo blade, mountain king cuirass, and mountain king gauntlets equipped in the legendarium. So that's it for the legendarium. Let's talk about pet skills. For the pet skills, I've tested on the test server things like this and this, and they were broken, and this was broken, and I think they're still broken because I've been testing them and I've not seen any results. So normally what I do is something like this. Zoomies, it goes very well with Dryad's neckband and token of invigoration if you're using it. Since we're using Mountain King gauntlets, I think deadlier strikes is not needed. That's why I go for Aura Defender, but you might prefer movement speed, or you might prefer block chance. So it's up to you which aura you take. I really like Zoomies though. And then I get Battlecry, and I really like Healing Friendship. So in my opinion, Healing Friendship is the must-have. The rest is optionally up to you, what you would want. Would you want more stuns, more defense, more damage? Would you want roots, etc.? Would you want this to proc, which I don't seem to be able to proc much. I wish I could get my pet to attack my dummy. I wish we had a force pet attack or pet slash minion attack movement button dedicated, separate from our hotbar. But yeah, that's it for the pet skills. Next, we are going to talk about gear. And here we are at the gear segment, where I'm going to talk about which items I'm using, why, and ideal roles for each of those items for each SWAT. First of all, I'd like to mention my gear is pretty shitty in regards to types of items. Yes, I've got some strong 117 extra stat power items, so my defenses are high with those two items. Even without them, I've got some items with double the sockets, which I think are overpowered and shouldn't exist in general. That whole challenge bonus is a big mistake, and it should not have been added to the game. It's adding a ton of disbalance between Fazir and any other activities they might add into the future, including the currently existing Secret Alpaca level. So keep that in mind. Those bolted stats are not something you would have as a new player. You won't have those stats until you have done high level Fazir. And as you go further into Fazir, this challenge bonus would grow, and your defense and damage would grow with it. I intentionally didn't use a stronger weapon, so I don't show you some weird stats. For example, I could have used this weapon, which is mediocre. It could go to 22,000 damage. This is only 15. But yeah, intentionally didn't use it, so I don't show you some shockingly high numbers, and then you're wondering how you get that number. Keep in mind, you need 3 pieces Mountain King equipped, 3 pieces Winter Weave equipped, as I said in the Legendarium segment. Ideally, in my opinion, that would be the Mountain King helmet, Gauntlet's wheel, and Winter Weave Pauldrons, Winter Weave Cuirass, and Winter Weave Hatch. As I mentioned, you can mix and match things like Winter Weave wheel, Mountain King wheel, one in the Legendarium, one worn. It's not a bad idea. The same goes for the Gauntlets, the same goes for the Cuirass. The things that must be Winter Weave, and I don't recommend using a Mountain King unless you have no other choice, would be the Pauldrons and the Hatch. Mountain King Hatch does zero things for our build. The Mountain King Pauldrons is okay, but it's shitty. It's not as good as the Winter Weave Pauldrons that give us a teleport skill, which we can put here. Then for the Winter Weave Helmet, I also don't suggest getting that one. Whereas this one could be either of the two, this one could be either of the two, this one could be either of the two. Mix and match what goes in the Legendarium, what you wear. You really want to wear an unstable war arm, it could be even level 1. You don't use it for damage, you use it for the legendary affix that gives you a bonus for Vortex Bomb if above 75 hit when venting. With it, you trigger a secondary heat wave dealing 400% weapon damage. So things like physical damage, crit chance, crit damage, chance to bleed, stun, shock, etc. Chance to knock back, chance to stun, chance to blind, flat damages of all types. They don't apply to any of your melee skills. To any of your melee skills, which means rapid strike, uppercut, tracking strike, cyclone mode, ramming robot, or vortex bomb would not benefit from bonuses from a cannon. The things that you do benefit from the cannon are things like bonus damage to basic attacks, mana cost reduction, energy cost reduction, energy recharge rate, things like those. So you're looking for such roles that don't affect chest gun damage skills, but that affect any type of skills and anything in general that buff your character. So even if it's level 1, if it has some good stats, wear it. Unstable war arm, best weapon for the setup, and best cannon for the setup. As the weapon, you either can go for a blue one with some flat damages, maybe crit damage and flat damage, maybe crit chance and flat damage, and some more flat damage in the sockets. And again, you're ideally striving to get something as strong as this, with instead of drain, extra flat damage, instead of blind, extra flat damage, and instead of the crit chance versus bleeding targets, extra flat damage, which would put you at around 22,000 damage, depending on how much you roll on each of those. You can even get lucky and get 23,000 damage if you're super lucky. With the wife binding and with the stats as bases. Anything above 15,000 is actually pretty good for max level Fazir, although it really does take a lot because the enemies are boring bullet sponges. But yeah, just consider that. Wife binding, a blue item gives you 20% stats. A legendary item already has 20% more stats than a blue. So legendary would be equal, but getting a good rolled legendary would be very hard. You see, I've got this one, which has bonus damage to basic attacks, 4 skill levels to swag shot, and additional bolts fired on shock. All 3 of those I don't need. I would prefer flat damage, or crit damage, or crit chance, or 2x flat damage, things like those. Would be much better. So something to consider as legendary items that are fine. For example, you can try using North Mace or the Glacier's Edge together with the Frost Wall. And that would be pretty fun if you're using some item granted skills, such as the things from the North Mace, or the thing from the Glacier's Edge, or the thing from Ancient Ember Boots. Or the skill from Arc Powered Shoulders. So this is what the Frost Wall does. It reduces the cooldown of item granted skills by 25, or with the set 50%, which is amazing. And the North Mace basically gives you this active skill Hailstorm, which I will try and show you just quickly what it does. Because this Q slot is empty. You can put whatever you want there. So you activate it, and then as you're attacking, your attacks have a chance to do this this piercing projectile. But it does very low damage. I haven't enabled the damage numbers. But yeah, it does low damage, so it's not that great. Next, what we're gonna talk about the shields. Again, Holy Icon is very good. Holy Icon is good, or you can go for a blue shield. There aren't that many great shields from the legendaries. Bone Walker is not gonna do much for this build. So, if you get a good blue one, get it. If you get a good Holy Icon, get it. If you get a good Frost Wall, use it. It's up to you. If you don't wanna use a shield, obviously use a interesting focus item. See, the Liu General is an interesting focus item, and it's apart from that set. Where did it go? I had one somewhere here. There we go, the Liu General. So it gives you damage, and it gives you damage reduction for 8 seconds when you reach maximum energy. But we don't reach maximum energy often on a build with Blood Seekers, because you're not dumping energy quickly enough. But the way it works is there's an interesting thing how the Liu General works. If you have the North Mace and Frost Wall equipped, I'm gonna quickly demonstrate it. You get the set bonus, you see, and then the Liu General would also get the set bonus if you put it in the Legendarium. If I were to remove the Servo Blade quickly for a moment and put the Liu General would get that set bonus. So as long as you have two pieces of the set equipped, you can slot a third piece of the set or a fourth piece of the set and get its bonus. So that's kind of how this works right now. Let's go over some of the perfect stat rolls you would want on each slot. On weapons, as I mentioned, flat damage is probably the best thing you can get. Crit damage and crit chance are very good as well. Damage to certain skills you can't get on that, but skill levels to certain skills you can get on the weapon, which I think is a waste though. On the helmet you can get crit chance and levels to certain skills, which are the best things to look for. Relic energy generation, minus relic energy cost are not bad. Defenses, sockets, obviously you want those. On shoulders you want this thing. Damage with servo driven uppercut, which should get renamed with the next patch to damage with steam powered uppercut. So if you get on the shoulder the damage, and if you get on the chest the same damage, and if you get on the locomotion this damage, you can get over 100% damage with the uppercut. And I've tested it, and damage with the uppercut in general tends to be better than getting flat damage on the chest, if uppercut is something you're using often. And it stacks. This 30, 20, etc. up to 100% you can get, 100 plus even percent you can stack. Would stack with the 200% the servo blade gives you. So right now the servo blade gives me, as you can see, for the uppercut, where did it go? It should say 200%. Did I equip it? I didn't click equip. It gives 200% damage there on the stats. So once you equip it, that 200% can go up to like 300 and so. And you can get super strong numbers on uppercut. So you can see right now we have 200% damage bonus, but resource cost as well. And you can see now this goes to 130%, which is how you start stacking it up. And you can get around 4000 weapon damage with the uppercut, with buffs and stuff like that. See, this buff gives you 3000 right now without a single extra percent. So if it's 300% right, 3000% right now, this can probably go to 4000 plus if you stack it. On the shoulders you can get crit damage as well, which is something I strongly recommend, and then sockets. On the Mountain King wheel you can get, or whatever wheel you're using, you can get the damage to uppercut with crit chance, but no crit damage. On the chest you can get flat damage or crit damage, but no crit chance. This one can also get flat damage, but I haven't seen one drop recently, so maybe they removed it and only keep it on the chests. And the hatch can give you crit damage, so you want that there. On the gloves you can get things like chance to bleed, duration for power projection, duration to sonic pulse, duration to... what was its name? Duration to butt seekers, those are good things there. And on the shield you want fat damage, then chance to block, then at the bottom defenses as much as you can get. And maybe you can add other things like elemental chances and things like that, or defenses based on what you need. For the pet skills and for the pet items, item granted skills, you want, I would say my best friend is Dryad's Neckband. On pet hits recover 3% health for you and the pet. And then you're stacking pet attack speed and this affix, faster cooldown for pet active skills. So ideally you would have Dryad Neckband that gives you pet attack speed and pet cooldown. And then on the bottom, on the neckband, you were gonna put whatever you want. But on the sockets for the tokens, you would put cooldown for the pet. This is the best you can put in the sockets. I like using token of rapid bartering with token of invigoration. When I don't have a good invigoration token, I use Phoenix token. But you can use whatever tokens you like, but my ideal combo is Dryad Neckband, rapid bartering and token of invigoration, and focusing on the cooldown and attack speed. And the attack speed really synergizes well with zoomies as well. And that's pretty much it. If I've missed anything, check my website version of the build on struckpub.xyz. This is a very long segment, so let's move on finally to show you some more of the game play footage of the build in action. And here we are at the gameplay segment where I show you more footage of the build in action and I talk about how I rotate my skills. Normally, obviously, you would wanna build heat, so Cyclone Motor, Rapid Strike to build the heat. Once the heat is built up, use Vent Vortex Bomb. But what I would suggest is before using Vent Vortex Bomb, use Sonic Pulse. Sonic Pulse makes the enemies take 40% damage, which applies to Vortex Bomb as well. And the tier 3 bonus of Sonic Pulse makes your your steam spending skills, such as the steam powered uppercut, do another 40% more damage. So you're boosting Vortex Bomb with Sonic Pulse, and right after a Vortex Bomb you would be using your steam skill, which would also benefit from the 40% damage and the other 40% damage, which is pretty nice increase. If your energy is high, activate Bloodseekers, and if you have the duration to Bloodseekers, that's gonna keep it up for a long time, and that's another 25% extra damage to your skills. So ideally you would start the combo, the rotation, with Bloodseekers when it's ready. And Dance of Death is there just as a filler, just so you can spend the energy. Maybe when they add the Echoes of Life back into the game, that would be a better choice. Dance of Death, if you level it to tier 1, it can give you extra bleed, which could help with proccing Rupture more often, but we're proccing Rupture often enough with Bloodletter without any bleed in my weapon, so I think it's pretty solid. So there's other things, as I said, that you can put in the Poison Dart, up to you what you put there, and Power Projection is there for extra defense and to heal us, and Ramming Robot for mobility. To get notified when I upload more content for this game or other games like this one, which would be Wooters of all varieties, isometric third-person ARPGs, Wooter shooters and all sorts of Wooters like that, you could subscribe to my channel and hit that bell button to not miss out on my content updates. And optionally, you can even join as a member of the Struck Club on YouTube as a channel member to get access to exclusive perks such as special emotes custom made by me, special badges custom made by me that represents how many months you have been a member for, as well as opt-in of editing tutorials that I can give for Photoshop, Adobe Premiere, as well as shoutouts and things like that. And I would like to use this part of the video to thank all my YouTube members and Twitch subscribers. Thank you for supporting the channel and keeping me going. Thank you also for watching this video, everyone. Keep it cool, Struck Club. Until next time, and goodbye.